Now, we would like to seek the rare honor by very humbly requesting the Honorable Chief Guest for the evening, the Chief Justice, Mr. Justice Surendra Kumar Sinha, sir, to grace the podium with his speech.
Barrister Sheikh Tapos Nur Tapos, MP, the editor of Bangladesh Legal Times, Mr. Anishul Haq, Honorable Minister for Law, Justice and Parliamentary Affairs, renowned journalists, lawyers, judges of the both divisions, representatives from print and electronic media, ladies and gentlemen, very good evening. I deem it a great honor and privilege for me to be here with you in this auspicious occasion. At the very outset, I express my sincere thanks to the editor, Bangladesh Legal Times, for inviting me to be the chief guest of this great occasion. Before embarking on my discussion, I do recall with profound respect the great contribution of Sheikh Fazlul Haq Mani, valiant freedom fighter, renowned journalist, who was assassinated along with the father of the nation, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, on 15th August 1971. You all know that Bangladesh is fortunate to have one of the finest constitution in the world. The rule of law is a basic feature of the Constitution of Bangladesh. It has been placed in the preamble of the Constitution of Bangladesh, I quote, "It shall be fundamental aim of the state to realize through the democratic process a socialist society free of exploitation, a society in which the rule of law, fundamental human rights and freedom, equality and justice, political, economic, and social will be secured for all citizens," unquote. "An independent, capable, and proactive judiciary is indispensable for the protection and advancement of democracy and rule of law. In Bangladesh, the judiciary, one of the three organs of the state, plays an important role for the advancement of democracy and human rights. Rule of law is the foundation of democratic society. Rule of law is, Aristotle said more than 2000 years ago, I quote, "The rule of law is better than that of any individual." Lord Chief Justice Cook, quoting Bacon, said, "The king himself ought not to be subject to man, but subject to God and the law, because the law makes him king." Rule of law is the legal principle that law should govern a nation, as opposed to being governed by arbitrary decisions of individual government officials. It primarily refers to the influence and authority of law within society, particularly as a constraint upon behavior, including behavior of government officials. The phrase can be traced back to 16th century England, and it was popularized in the 19th century British jurist A.B. Daishi. The concept was familiar to ancient philosophers such as Aristotle, who wrote, "Law should govern." Rule of law implies that every citizen is subject to the law, including lawmakers themselves. In this sense, it stands in contrast to an autocracy, collective leadership, dictatorship, or oligarchy, where rulers are held above the law. Democracy is a way of life. It cannot be begotten overnight. It cannot be handed down in a silver platter. It cannot be earned. It has to be owned. The world history is replete with stories of people, ordinary people, who fought with their rights in different names of in different countries, but the cry for liberty, the cry for equality, the cry for fraternity, we are overburdened in a similar manner from horizon to horizon. This sense of liberty made us independent from the yoke of British rule in 1947, and the same sense of liberty pushed us through the War of Liberation in 1971 and brought Bangladesh into existence. But the proclamation of martial law is altogether the negation of the spirit of liberty and independence. Our Supreme Court is the creature of the Constitution. It has played a vital role during the crisis period of the country, similarly in the manner as US Supreme Court played role just immediately after its independence, and the Indian Supreme Court at all levels. In all fields, such as violation of human rights, maintenance of rule of law, independence of judiciary to protect environmental degradation, encroachment of government property by the trespassers. In order to protect the killers of Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman and his family members, indemnity ordinance was promulgated. Our Supreme Court had removed all barriers to hold trial of those killers. And ultimately, the trial was concluded and the highest court of the country maintained the conviction and some of the killers were executed. Four leaders were brutally murdered in the prison bar, and the ulterior motive was trial of the killers were stopped. In a short span of time, trial of those killers were concluded and sentenced them in accordance with law. Eventually, the Supreme Court maintained the conviction of the killers. During our liberation war, Pakistan Occupation Army, along with local collaborators, committed atrocities, war crimes, crimes against humanity, genocide, violence against 2 lakh human, and enjoyed impunity for almost 4 decades. Pakistani armed collaborators and members of Al-Badr al-Shams brutally killed intellectuals on December 1971 at the dawn of freedom, aiming to deprive the new nation of its best brains. But eventually, the perpetrators and criminals who helped Pakistani army to commit genocide and crimes against humanity were brought to justice. Some of them were tried under the International Crimes Tribunal Act 1973 and handed down exemplary punishment, and the apex court maintained the conviction and sentence of some veteran criminals. The trial is continuing. The Supreme Court pronounced a historical judgment by declaring 5th and 7th Amendment of the Constitution and the martial law proclamations, martial law orders, illegal, and directed to slash out the same from Constitution, and in an unequivocal word observed to the effect, I quote, "We are putting on record our total disapproval of martial law and suspension of Constitution or any other thereof, any part thereof in any form. The perpetrators of such illegalities should also be suitably punished and condemned so that in future no adventurist, no usurper would dare to defy the people. Their constitution, their government established by them with their consent. However, it is the parliament which can make law in this regard. Let us bid farewell to all kinds of extra constitutional adventure forever," I unquote. Accordingly, the parliament in 15th amendment of the constitution incorporated article 7A of the constitution, providing for highest punishment for the offense of abrogation, suspension, etc. of the constitution. Supreme Court knocked down the 8th Amendment of the Constitution and thereby maintained rule of law and clearly declared the basic structure of the Constitution cannot be violated and abused in no way. Supreme Court declared the 13th Amendment of the Constitution as unconstitutional and as such restored democracy. The Supreme Court, by its judgment in Muzammel Hossain case, glorified the judiciary and directed the government to separate the subordinate judiciary from executive. Accordingly, the government did it. Predictably, the executive never took kindly to the judgment of the 8th Amendment of Muzammel Hossain case. Even some political parties were not kind enough to accept the 5th, 7th, and 13th Amendment of Constitution, and the executive made various attempts to ensure that the judiciary became subservient to the government. Each and every time, the Supreme Court rises to the occasion to rescue the country, judiciary, and the people. Independent judiciary is the heart of the republic, the foundation of democracy, the source of its parental vitality, the condition for its growth, and the hope of its welfare. All lie in the great institution, the Supreme Court of Bangladesh, an independent judiciary. But by the same time, Supreme Court also conscious about the role, about its role, and it has never transgressed the power of other organs of the state. It always keeps in mind, I quote, excessive authority without liberty is intolerable. But excessive liberty without authority and without responsibility sometimes become equally intolerable. When the 44th Amendment Bill of Indian Constitution was prepared, the statement of objects and reasons echoed some of Jawaharlal Nehru's words, I quote, a constitution to be living must be growing, unquote. If the impediments of growth of the constitution are not removed, constitution will suffer virtually atrophy, unquote. I hope that our constitution, being a social document, the impediments in the administration of justice are required to be removed for the sake of independence of judiciary, so that we may lay a safe foundation for safety and security of our next generation. For an emerging nation, the first and foremost thing is to be looked into the rule of law and the independence of judiciary. Nation's civilization, respect, and pride depend upon how the country maintains rule of law. Many nations around the globe have enormous resources, and their per capita income is 10 times or higher than ours. But because of lack of rules, they are not recognized as a civilized country and respected by the international community. Lawyers were at the vanguard of the liberation movement. The practicing lawyer was given a pride of place of our constitution. In the fundamental rights chapter itself, in Article 32.1, it is proclaimed that no person who is arrested shall be denied the right to consult and be defended by a legal practitioner of his choice. The Supreme Court alone cannot maintain rule of law without support and cooperation of the members of the bar. The lawyers of the Supreme Court have a glorious past. They have played a great role to uphold the rule of law, independence of judiciary. They conjointly protested the bifurcation of the Supreme Court. Consequently, some prominent lawyers of the country were detained. Eventually, they achieved their cherished goal. This, they raised their voice, irrespective of political affiliation, against the appointment of judges without consultation of the Chief Justice. Nowadays, it is unfortunate to note that lawyers are politically motivated. They do not raise their voice against the political parties belonging to him or its leader. Some lawyers develop their mentality in commercialization of the profession. They are not interested to give their due attention of hearing substantive matters like suits, first appeals, and rates, etc. We always discover serious flaws in plaints, written statements, writ petitions, and even in bail petitions and injunction petitions. The quality of drafting legal instruments is degrading day by day. They are interested of hearing injunction and bail matters, etc. As a result, we hardly find good number of lawyers, with some exception of hearing substantive matters. If this continues, I do apprehend that judiciary will be in peril within 20 to 25 years, and as a result, the rule of law, which is foundation of democracy, will be a far cry. A lawyer of great competence, Mr. Fali S. Nariman, clearly spelled out regarding the lawyers and legal profession in the following words, I quote, "We demean ourselves and our profession when we resolve to strike work and so paralyze the working of courts, tribunals, and statutory authorities where public cases and causes demand our expertise, intercession, and assistance. We also discredit ourselves and our profession when we curry favor with those of authority and power and do not stand up and defend the rights of citizens," unquote. I will urge lawyers' community to be united for the cause of rule of law, democracy, and independence of judiciary. Like other countries throughout South Asia and beyond, the people of Bangladesh face significant hurdles in assessing their judicial system. Vulnerable groups, including the poor, women, children, ethnic minorities, and people with disabilities, face particular exclusion. Throughout the formal justice system, there is a significant lack of capacity within the judiciary, relevant ministries, and statutory bodies. There are some specific constraints to access to justice, including prohibitive costs, corruption, and undue influence, and lack of awareness of legal rights. Long delay in court processes is caused by a variety of factors, including a lack of management capacity, both at the district and national level, lack of coordination between justice sector actors, lack of trained staff, and shortages of judges, lack of trained and competent lawyers, etc. After resumption of office as Chief Justice of Bangladesh, I inspected the courts of the subordinate judiciary to find out the problems they are facing and the areas needed to be intervened. I found, alongside shortage of judges, paucity of logistic support, and inadequate infrastructures contribute to case backlog. How a modern society can conceive that a judge is waiting for his turn to come to use courtroom for hearing and deciding cases? The government has to look into this reality and take urgent steps to solve courtroom crisis. I can give the nation assurance that even with all constrictions, judges are working tirelessly to serve the people under the mandate of the Constitution. I have issued practice directions to them to utilize best of their court hours, and following my directions, judges of the subordinate judiciary are now doing judicial business in two shifts. That is, even after the recess at noon. I caused to issue circular prohibiting station leave by the judges of the subordinate judiciary so that their 100% effort and energy can be utilized in judicial work. I urge the lawyers to cooperate with court in hearing cases in the afternoon. All courts have to bear in mind that we cannot afford to sit idle while millions of cases are pending. a well-functioning judiciary as a prerequisite of a country's economic performance is increasingly attracting public and policymakers' attention as it promotes efficient production and distribution of goods and services by securing, among other things, the enforcement of contracts and promoting social harmony. Indeed, an effective judiciary acquires particular significance today when democratization, urbanization, and adoption of market reforms have made social interactions complex and improvement of judicial conflict resolution capabilities and service delivery more important than ever before. A judiciary that enforces rule of law would hasten trade, financing, investment, and promote social peace. You know that on 28/8/2016, Supreme Court signed a memorandum of understanding with A2I project of Prime Minister's Office. The purposes of the memo of understanding is to help introduce e-judiciary in Bangladesh. We have already introduced digital court recording system in Sylhet as piloting. On the basis of the result of piloting going on in Sylhet district, it will be replicated in other districts by turns. For complete digitalization, some procedural laws are required to be extensively overhauled. But it is very, I say, the Honorable Law Minister is here. We are speaking about digitalization, but our law is totally silent in this regard, particularly the law of evidence. And it is very difficult on our part to administer justice because of lack of proper law. Today, by and large, Bangladesh judiciary enjoys immense public confidence. The common man considers the judiciary the ultimate guardian of his rights and liberties. This institution has stood the test of time, and we owe it to the great institution to which we belong that we maintain the confidence of the common man in the judiciary by giving ever-handed justice in all cases. I should remind the judges that the judiciary has no army or police force to execute its mandates or compel obedience to its decrees. It has no control over the power strings of government. Those two historic sources of power rest in other hands. Strength of the judiciary is in the command it has over the hearts and minds of men. The respect and prestige are the product of innumerable judgments and decrees, a mosaic built from the multitude of cases decided. Respect and prestige do not grow suddenly. They are products of time and experience. But they flourish when judges are independent and courageous. The court that raises its hand against the mob may be temporarily unpopular, but it soon wins the confidence of the nation. The court that fails to stand before the mob is not worthy of the great tradition. Terrorism in any form has been one of the constant life-threatening concerns affecting more or less every country of the world in the 21st century. Terrorism has no country, and it is a threat to the whole mankind. Terrorism is an instrument of the worst enemies of the mankind, bent on suppressing and crushing the people's struggle for global peace and security. It is a symptom, not the disease, and the reason of disease are mainly poverty, religious fanaticism, illiteracy, social inequality, sense of deprivation, or frustration. As a peace-loving country, Bangladesh is fully committed and ready to fight against terrorism and support on meaningful steps to be taken by the international community to combat the minors. If the rule of law is not maintained in a country, their terrorism may sneak into the country. For example, due to lack of rule of law, one of the European countries is not qualified to be a member of the European Union. In our country, we have paucity of English magazine relating to law. There is no doubt that it is a novel venture to publish a new law journal. The work of law journal is primarily intended for practitioners, but it will contain matters deserving the attention of political scientists and constitutional lawyers. This is a monumental work and obviously a comprehensive encyclopedia on our law and practice, which will bear comparison with any similar publication on English law. I hope this journal will bear penetration to formidable and forbidding topics. This magazine will always have a place on the desk of the law bench of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh and lawyers. We hope no standard law journal. All the time we are depending upon foreign journals, especially Indian law journals. This will help increase the legal knowledge of law students, lawyers, judges, and all other stakeholders. In fact, by reading the magazine, Bangladesh Legal Times, they will be conversant regarding the latest development, different branches of jurisprudence. The enterprise, it is expected, will accelerate the growth of legal journalism in our country. In this respect, I will urge the legal luminaries, judges, legal experts to contribute to enrich the magazine, the Bangladesh Times. I believe that the law will create a new dimension in legal arena. Before I conclude, I want to say a few words about Barrister Tapas. Barrister Tapas, we know how you faced your life, practical life. In your early life, you lost your parents. Then you stood yourself. I believe, I do believe, in the manner, the great personalities over the globe, all great personalities, Mahatma Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, even Barack Obama, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, Motilal Nehru, all great personalities that did not have any backing. They stood on their own legs, and you are one of them. I hope you will stand on your own legs, and you will be successful in your endeavor. Before I parting with, I must say that the worthy son of Sheikh Fazlur Rahmani, Barrister Sheikh Fazlur Tapas, the editor, Bangladesh Legal Times, will surely carry out his late lamented father's legacy and heritage in the print media. I wish wide leadership of Bangladesh Legal Times. Thank you all. Thank you.